I'm going to expand on the wonderful talks from Bill and Sarah in terms of bench to bedside or scientific discovery to clinical translation of our work at Dana-Farber. But before I do that, I will tell you that that was a foreign concept to me. I actually was the first person in my family to ever go to college. I was going to honestly go into medicine because my mother was a nurse, and I was going to be a general practitioner in a small town. And I went to college, and I got turned on to research. I worked as a volunteer orderly, and I got confirmed interest in medicine. But it wasn't until I went to medical school that I got exposed to the kind of work that you've heard about. The idea that you can make models of diseases in the laboratory or in animals that can be used to help teach or improve the diagnosis, prognosis, and treatment of patients. That lesson was taught to me by my very first medical school teacher, make science count for patients. And the second lesson that he taught me many years ago was to treat patients as family. So I came to Dana-Farber almost 40 years ago, and I found out that those two lessons, making science count for patients and treating patients as family, permeate our institution. You're part of that. I went into the group and formed a group that made models of this disease called multiple myeloma in the laboratory and in animals. And we used those models over now decades to define vulnerabilities, weaknesses, where we could interrupt the growth, survival, or drug resistance of these cells or turn on their death. And over the years, what happens is once we have identified a target, we look around for a biotech or a pharmaceutical that has an inhibitor or a drug that might target that weakness. We partner with them. We then move on. We work with the FDA to design clinical trials that would show safety and efficacy. We work with the patients who are the heroes and inspirations for all that we do. And these drugs get FDA approved. And after that, we go further and write guidelines so people know how to use the drugs and have access to the drugs in the United States and around the world. So I'm very proud to tell you that we've done that 20 times over the career in our myeloma center, and things have really improved. When I started, patients lived only a few months, and now it's really common to have myeloma as a chronic illness and people growing old and dying from something else. Now, what's been special about that is the patients. You know some of them, Geraldine Ferraro, Lenny Zakum, right now Tom Brokaw, but some of them you don't know. Like the lady that I saw last week that I treated in 1988 at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute on a new clinical trial, who is sharing with me how she's now a grandmother and about to become a great-grandmother. The other side, besides the patient joy, is actually what we do at Dana-Farber, which is to train in science and in clinical medicine the next generation of researchers and caregivers. And I have what's called the United Nations Against Myeloma, because I've had people come from all over the world. Not too long ago, I returned from Japan, where I had a reunion of 60 different doctors from Japan who have studied in my group and are now brought knowledge and care of new advances to that country. So let me give you a couple of quick examples of how this works. It builds on the talks of Bill and Sarah. So myeloma makes too much protein. So back in the 1990s, we hypothesized that potentially, if we could block the ability of the myeloma cell to dispose of this protein in a garbage disposal system called the proteasome, just maybe these cells would fill up with their own protein and commit suicide and die. And David Livingston referred somebody who had made a proteasome inhibitor, a drug that blocked the garbage can, to work with me, named Julian Adams. And we tested this drug in our systems, and it was really very effective. So this went forward in the late 90s into clinical trials, first in man showing safety and efficacy. Paul Richardson at our institute led the late stage trials, and it was FDA approved. And as we're sitting here this morning, it's the most commonly used drug all around the world now, and many patients and their families have really benefited. Not only that, we have second generation oral inhibitors that are better tolerated, And we have multiple ongoing efforts to target this garbage can called the proteasome system in myeloma. So that was an example of working with an existing company. It happened to be called Millennium at the time. And David Schenkheim, who was speaking at lunch, was actually working at Millennium at the time. But cancer cells become resistant, as many of you know. They're very clever. And so patients' tumors became resistant to Velcade. So we decided to study why, and we found out that the escape route that sometimes was used was the other garbage can called the agrosome. And in this case, the inhibitors of the agrosome, the other garbage disposal system, did not exist. But that's where all of you in this room come in, and especially the Lindy family, who donated generously and established chemical biology expertise at Dana-Farber, as you've just heard about from Sarah. So I'm very proud to say that Jay Bradner and colleagues synthesized an agrosome garbage disposal inhibitor. It's a selective HDAC inhibitor. And we brought it into our systems and showed that, in fact, does block that alternative system. And if you block both systems, it is really an unhappy myeloma event. So these combinations then went forward. But the other new innovative feature here, besides the fact that the drug was made in academia, is that it went forward in a new angel investor company. The purpose there was to just show in very early stages that it was safe and what's the dose to use. And I'm proud to tell you now it is going forward in advanced stages of clinical trials, this time under the auspices of Big Pharma again. Now, I want to mention one other quick thing. Back in the 1990s, the other class of drugs that we and others were interested in was called the immunomodulatory drugs. Those are drugs like thalidomide that you know well, and related drugs like lenalidomide and pomalidomide. We studied those back then in our preclinical models and showed that they actually had direct effects on myeloma and indirect effects. In particular, they turned on the immune system in patients against their own myeloma. So these went forward from our center very rapidly to clinical trials, FDA approval. They're used all over the place now. And if you combine the immunomodulatory drugs with the proteasome inhibitors, 100% of people with myeloma respond. But beyond that, you've heard already this morning, and you'll hear more today, about the revolution in immune therapies. But these pills, these immunomodulatory drugs, are being used to augment the immune system. And as we're here this morning, we're using those now in the context of vaccines, where you vaccinate patients, generate an immune response, and then use the immunomodulatory drugs to amplify that response. We're using them with monoclonal antibodies that are given by vein. They go in and bind to the fingerprint proteins on cancer, marking them for destruction by the immune system. And if you do that and then add in these immunomodulatory drugs, you augment the immune response. Now, I wanted to mention it because Bill Kalin, sitting in the front row, and Ben Ebert, our new chief of adult oncology, actually showed how these work. And they work by triggering protein degradation, exactly opposite to what I've told you for the proteasome inhibitors. But this has spawned a whole new area of medicine. Medicines now that are targeting degradation of specific proteins. So for example, hormone receptors on breast or prostate cancer, BTK in Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, or maybe proteins in viral diseases to prevent the viral replication. So a whole new class of medicines. So I just want to close and mention to you again that Dana-Farber is, in fact, the premier place for science, discovery. What makes us very special, and the colleagues are just awesome, is that we can take these discoveries and make them count for patients. All around the world, patients are benefiting, And while we're doing this, we're training the next generation of researchers and caregivers. So we heard a wonderful dialogue last night by Larry Summers. My take-home message was, we live in a very tumultuous and complicated world where people don't take care of each other anymore. But I just want to tell you, because of your generosity, all of us in this room are making the world a better place for patients. In particular, you're giving, by supporting us in our efforts, you're giving the gift of hope and the gift of life to patients and their families. And honestly, there's no greater gift than that. Thanks very much.